is here from an organization called Symbol, which is...
Can you speak louder?
Yes, which is the firm that I've been with
for... better if he came here. Can you, who's going to be the speaker?
I'll go.
Okay. Have a seat.
That way they can hear it on the TV.
Right. That way people on...
Our listening audience.
Our vast home audience.
All of our fans. Our studio audience.
I actually had a fellow come up to me who I know 1 year and said, I saw you on TV last night. So I know it. I know it happens.
So here we are a year later, and
so who are the players that you're representing at this point?
In terms of insurance companies?
Yes.
We went through this year, and when we talked to Heather and did our annual risk survey, which we do each year, there is a protocol in terms of the best time to go to market. You don't want to do it every year, because underwriters will come back and say, you know what, we're not in the business of practicing. If you're serious, come to us, and if not. So we went to the marketplace this year, and the companies that we worked with, it's all in the detail on the addendum, were Travelers and Chubb and Cincinnati and Utica, which is the carrier that we're recommending that the library consider this year, as well as Philadelphia. Philadelphia is the incumbent insurer that does our property and casualty insurance, as well as professional and crime coverage, employee dishonesty, et cetera. That's the range of carriers. To provide some historical perspective, the insurance program that the library has now is a result of design and dialogue back and forth with both the board of directors and management over time, and reflects decisions that the board's made in the past in terms of how much directors and officers liability insurance, in terms of the financial position of the library and requirements for bonding of the treasurer, et cetera. So we can, I'd be happy to run through the specifics of the proposal, but it's essentially comparable to the program that's currently in place. The pieces are the property and casualty piece, building, commercial general liability, business automobile, as well as workers' compensation coverage. And then the professional coverages, which is coverage for directors and officers. And there is, in the event of that someone brings an action or makes a claim that says that you're failing in your responsibilities as directors and officers.
So with Utica, am I pronouncing it right?
You are.
There's no professional package in that quote, but then you've got it down there for Chubb?
The proposal that we're putting together in terms of our recommendation is on page 12. And it's three carriers. And you can look at the detail on page 13. But the proposal is to continue with the professional package coverage that's provided currently with Philadelphia. And their renewal terms are $8,382. The Utica property and casualty package is $35,640. Which is a reduction from expiring. And then we have a little accident policy that we put in place a number of years ago, primarily to address friends of the library, but it also addresses exposures for directors and officers as you're coming and going in terms of an accident exposure. One of the things that we have worked with here, Chubb has been an insurer that's provided coverage for the library in the past on many of its coverages, as has Travelers. Currently, we're with Philadelphia Insurance Company. And through the years, when there have been claims, each of those carriers has performed very, very well. to the satisfaction of both management and the board. And what I would say about what we do and what we bring to the table is the ability to have that dialogue, to raise the important questions, and we have one that we've recommended for a number of years with respect to cyber liability, and to be the library's advocate and to provide the management and board of directors with our advice. The continuing recommendation that we raised a number of times is that the library consider adding cyber insurance coverage to its program. You can go downstairs and pick up, you know, any business magazine or today's newspaper, and you will see reports of cyber losses. It's a continuing exposure. The library is in a position where many of its services are provided by third parties, and I know that you've had legal counsel look at those contracts. But in the event of a serious loss, one of the principal things that you're buying with cyber coverage is advice on a timely basis so that you can avoid taking steps, making announcements, and make the appropriate notifications to stay out of trouble. And there is all you have to do is, again, look at your various periodicals, and you'll find major corporations that have not made those
observations. So is cyber insurance included in your estimate?
It is not.
Okay.
We'll need to go through an application process in order to do that. There's some nominal cyber coverage that's built in to the directors and officers liability policy, but we think that you ought to have a robust directors and officers.
Could you give us an example of something that we wouldn't want to have happen and how the cyber insurance would cover that?
Insurers recognize that they can't merely buy or put together an insurance program and say, here's your cyber insurance coverage and forget about it. Organizations need advice at critical times. And insurers have created relationships with service companies and law firms so that if something happens, you get a notice, your computers are locked up because they're saying, you know, we've taken control of it, and unless you come up with enough Bitcoin, you're not going to have access to your systems any longer. Insurers, the services that you're buying, and whatever carrier that we would present would do this, provide the advice to make sure that you take the appropriate steps. Mm. The advice piece is almost more important than the insurance financial loss.
So it's almost like getting getting a really good consultant in that area.
Yes.
Rather than having it go.
One of the things that you want to do, that any organization wants to do if in the event of a cyber loss, is to make sure that the first people that they're talking with, that the discussions are covered by attorney-client privilege. Because you don't want that to be discoverable. What do we do? Who do we talk to? How do we provide an announcement? If you've seen these claims take place, there are about 46 different jurisdictions that could say, you have to follow our rules and regulations. Now, we're an Illinois entity. I understand that most of our exposures are either under Illinois law or federal law here, and that we're not really concerned about Montana and California, but we could be. And that's one of the great impetuses for making sure that cyber is part of it.
This is a basic question.
Yes.
Is this an annual premium or monthly premium?
These are all annual.
Okay, thank you.
You bet.
Just to get a feel for cyber coverage, I mean, I'm just an indication of the cost. I'm jumping here, John. I mean, you can start out, and Travelers does it, Chubb does it, Hartford, all the big players, and as the market starts to develop, the prices are becoming a bit more competitive, bidding against one another. But for $1 million coverage limit, you might be looking at $3,000 a year. Mm-hmm. And that would cover what John's talking about, the ransom piece. I have a country club client, this goes back a few years, and they came in one morning and their computers were frozen, and there was a demand for bitcoins. They did not have insurance coverage, and they called the local police department and got nowhere. Well, the suggestion was to maybe contact the FBI. So what John's talking about is to be able to pick up the phone and call Travelers, call Chuck, whoever, and they have the professionals that can step in and tell you exactly what needs to be done. If they have to pay the ransom, or if they have to go through a specific notification process, that's your resource.
And you don't want to be waiting and fooling around with other things. Yeah.
Well, we've been talking about it internally, certainly. I mean, one of our challenges is our consortium, CCS, has cyber insurance for our catalog ILS system, which is a significant portion of our operations. So we want to tease out a little bit, like, how the coverage would be different from what we are already covered under with our consortium. So that's just one of the reasons that we haven't gotten a quote at this time, but it is certainly on our radar.
I don't mean that critically. Yeah. I actually have reviewed their policy for the library in the past.
Yeah, thank you.
And as part of what you explained, sorry, if obviously there's a maximum what the covers in terms of damage, but in terms of like bringing in some kind of cybersecurity people to fix the problem, is that the insurance also pays for that? Okay, so.
So can you tell us about the True North merger?
Yeah, what happened to Nimble?
We made a very deliberate decision to associate to become part of a larger firm. Mm-hmm. Because the world's changing so quickly. I brought up cyber insurance, but the world is changing. The dynamics are such that I felt that we needed a more robust backbone, if you will. Mm-hmm. And we looked at many firms and decided to become part of True North. And True North is a very dynamic firm. It's the 50th largest independent insurance agency in the United States and growing very quickly. It operates in many states. It has a particular expertise in cyber insurance, as a matter of fact. Mm-hmm. And Dan, you've been part of True North for a longer period of time than I have, obviously.
An agency up on Des Plaines, which was on its fourth generation of ownership. And in our industry, there is some consolidation. But what we found is we needed to be part of a larger organization to have more, more of a relationship with more insurance carriers. And so we became part of True North. And I think that's part of the reason John joined forces also. Headquartered out of Cedar Rapids, founded in 2001, and they've evolved into, you know, being one of the top brokers in the country. A very young group of people that work there, a lot of talented people, about bringing people from Iowa State and Iowa here, Illinois State, Katie School of Insurance as interns, and they have a really great program for talented young people where they keep the ownership internal. As owners reach age 62, they have to start divesting your ownership, and it goes to the next generation of younger people coming up through the company. So they train the talent, and then they keep them on board with this opportunity for ownership down the road. It's been a great change for us. We're going on our second year with them, and we're just totally thrilled to have John part of it too.
What's some of their library experiences in terms of
libraries? I don't have a lot of library experience. I know there are other people within the firm. I have one library account, if you want to call it that. It's the Center for Research Libraries. They're at the University of Chicago, more of a consortium where they collect data that's then fed out through universities throughout the country for research. I wish I could tell you what their budget is, but fairly large organization, but that is my only library type account client. One of the things that we do is we look to become a business partner. So from the standpoint of delivering, you know, a quality insurance product at a competitive price, we're there today, we're there during the policy term, we don't disappear. But then we talk to you about things that are maybe on your mind. What are the concerns you have? Cyber, obviously. We had a gentleman here earlier today, I mean, an active shooter situation. You could have ergonomic issues. You could have issues that might pertain to high voltage coming into the building. And together, we talk about things that we might be able to help you with as far as training, when it comes to ergonomic issues, or when it comes to infrared testing of high voltage equipment. It's being proactive and just kind of staying ahead of the curve a little bit with things that might pertain to training, train the trainer for active shooter situations where you send somebody out to be trained and they come back and work with the rest of the staff to get them familiar with maybe things that can be done. So you know, that's what we look at, not just delivering a good policy at a competitive price, but you know, working together to find things that can make you guys more successful, avoid interruptions whenever possible.
Jen, I have a fundamental question. What does our policy run from? I mean, when we're insured right now with you, when are we, our current premium, when does it go to?
We extend.